In the following lecture, we're going to talk about nuclear magnetic resonance, which is an analytical technique. And specifically in this first lecture, we're going to study about hydrogen NMR. The H-NMR provides us with very useful information about the environment of these hydrogen protons. So it's very useful in organic compounds. Now, organic compounds have a lot of hydrogen protons. So pick any organic compound, most of the time there would be lots of terminal hydrogen protons or hydrogen atoms attached to it. Now, the useful information about the environment of the hydrogen protons, you would be able to figure out whether the hydrogen is bonded to an oxygen or whether that hydrogen is bonded to a carbon chain, and at what position of the carbon chain is it bonded to. So you can basically figure out by looking at the environment of these hydrogen protons. For example, if I know the environment of this hydrogen proton, I know that it is bonded to oxygen, which is bonded to carbon and making a double bond oxygen, I would be able to figure out the structure of this entire molecule. If I know that this hydrogen is bonded to a carbon, which is bonded to two carbons on both sides, and on one side there's a carbon double bond oxygen. So by just figuring out what the environment around these hydrogen atoms is, I am able to figure out the rest of the structure of the molecule. So NMR is a very useful technique when it comes to organic chemistry. By simply getting information about the environment of hydrogen protons, you would be able to figure out the complete structure of different organic molecules. So we are now going to discuss how H-NMR works, what's the concept behind H-NMR, and how we're going to determine the chemical environment or the environment of these hydrogen protons. So the first thing you need to know is that hydrogen protons or hydrogen atoms, they can act as tiny magnets. So this is a simple diagram of a hydrogen atom. It's a very simple atom. It only has one proton and one electron. So our focus is on this proton, which is why I'm always referring to hydrogen as protons, because I'm not interested in this electron yet. I'm only interested in this proton in the nucleus. Its nucleus only has one proton. Now let's for a second ignore this electron, outside electron. Let's focus on the nucleus of hydrogen, which only has a proton. So I've drawn a nucleus of hydrogen which contains one proton. Now each proton or neutron in the nucleus has an accompanying magnetic field. So this blue line over here shows the magnetic field direction. So there's going to be a north pole and a south pole. Not only does a proton have a charge, but it also has a magnetic field. This magnetic field is known as magnetic spin moment. Or it's also sometimes referred to as magnetic dipole. So there's going to be, so you can also call it a dipole, a magnetic dipole. So it has a north pole and a south pole. So these hydrogen protons are acting as tiny magnets. So if there's an atom containing all these hydrogen atoms bonded to it, its nucleus would be acting as a tiny magnet, having a north pole and a south pole. So I've drawn this ethanoic acid molecule, and you can see all these hydrogen atoms with the protons, with the nuclei. Remember I told you that the proton of a hydrogen atom is going to act as a tiny magnet, so it's going to have a magnetic field. So there's north pole and south pole. So each of these hydrogen atoms, they would be exhibiting a magnetic field. So I've drawn these arrows over here. They're pointing in random directions. All of these are acting as tiny magnets with the magnetic fields. The arrow represents the magnetic field, the north pole and the south pole. Whereas these other atoms, what happens to these other atoms? You have carbon and you have two carbon atoms, one oxygen atoms. These atoms, they do not exhibit a magnetic field. And the reason is that even numbered nucleons always have paired magnetic spin moments. Hence, they don't have any overall magnetic spin moment or no overall magnetic field, because they're all going to get cancelled out. What that basically means is that if you look at a carbon atom, it has a total of 6 protons and a total of 6 neutrons. Now these are the nucleons. It has a total of 12 nucleons or particles in its nucleus. So there are 12 nucleons. So those 12 nucleons would be arranged in a paired fashion. What that means is that if one nucleon has a magnetic field pointing in this direction, in the upward direction, the other nucleon is going to have a magnetic spin that's pointing in the downward direction. So the overall magnetic field of this pair would cancel out. One magnetic field would cancel out the other magnetic field. So you have a total of 12 nucleons, 6 protons and 6 neutrons. Each one has a magnetic spin. So 6 would be pointing upwards, 6 would be pointing downwards. They would all be paired, and they're all going to cancel each other out, which is why there's not going to be any magnetic field. So these atoms over here, carbon and oxygen, any atom that has even number of nucleons, oxygen has a total of 16 nucleons. A lot of atoms actually have an even number of nucleons. So oxygen has 16 nucleons, carbon has 12 nucleons. These atoms are not going to exhibit an overall magnetic spin or an overall magnetic field, and therefore they would not have any magnetic field associated with them. Only the hydrogen atoms, because of their odd number of nucleons, the magnetic field is not getting cancelled out. They are the ones that would be acting as tiny magnets. So the question now is, how would you figure out by just looking at the magnetic fields of these hydrogen atoms, how would you figure out the structure of this molecule? How would this help you in determining the structure of any molecule, organic molecule? Now, I'll come up with an analogy, and that is of a compass needle. Remember that our hydrogen protons, they're acting as tiny magnets. A compass needle is a tiny magnet, and it is a magnet which has one end, which is the north-seeking end. So if it's placed in the Earth's magnetic field, it's always pointing in the north direction. So there's a north-seeking end, and it would be pointing in the direction of the Earth's magnetic field. So the compass needle automatically aligns with the Earth's magnetic field or the external magnetic field that it's placed in. This would be called the low energy state, because so this is your low energy state. The reason I'm calling it a low energy state is because you don't need to do any work. No external work needs to be done. The compass needle by itself would be pointing in the direction of the Earth's magnetic field. Now, what's going to happen now is, if I want to turn or point the compass needle in another direction, so here I've drawn the same compass needle, but now it's pointing in the opposite direction, which it's not supposed to. The only way I can make this compass needle point in the opposite direction is that if I pick it up and I turn it in the other direction. Now, to make it turn in the other direction, I would need to apply work. I would have to manually do this. So work needs to be done. Work needs to be done. You have to pick this compass needle and forcefully point it in the opposite direction so that it no longer points in the direction of the Earth's magnetic field, but points in the opposite direction. Now, this would be referred to as your high energy state. The reason we're calling this the high energy state is because the compass would only point in the opposite direction if you're applying work, if you're doing work. As soon as you stop doing this work, if I let it go, the compass needle would automatically lose its high energy state and would again, by default, move into the low energy state. It would again start pointing in the direction of the Earth's magnetic field. So when you apply work, when you do work and you forcefully point the compass needle in the opposite direction, that would be your high energy state, and the high energy state would only be maintained as long as you're doing work. As soon as you let it go, it's going to point back into towards the Earth's magnetic field. So there's a high energy state and there's a low energy state. Now, the concept of resonance is going to be exactly the same, and now you have to apply the same concept to hydrogen protons. So the compass needle points in a particular direction according to the external magnetic field, but if you apply work, if you forcefully point it in the other direction, it starts pointing in the other direction. That's high energy state. And as soon as you let it go, it's going to point to the direction of the Earth's magnetic field back again, and it's going to move to the low energy state. So resonance is when particles move from low energy state to high energy state and vice versa. So we're going to now apply the same concept to hydrogen protons. So I have this molecule over here of ethanoic acid, and you can see the protons having the magnetic spins, magnetic fields, and they're all pointing in random directions. And I have these magnets over here. There's a north pole and there's a south pole. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to place these this molecule in this magnetic field. And if I do so, the first thing that would happen is initially these protons, they are randomly aligned. They're not pointing in any specific direction. So I've now placed this molecule in this external magnetic field, and where let's first plot the direction of this external magnetic field. The magnetic field, and remember, the external magnetic field is, we're going to assume that it's very strong. It's always pointing from the north to the south. So this arrow over here represents the direction of the external magnetic field. What this external magnetic field would do is, it's going to force all these protons to align with it. Just like the compass needle. If you remember the compass needle would always point in the direction of the Earth's magnetic field. So these protons, initially they were pointing in random directions, but once they are placed in this external magnetic field, they are all going to start pointing in the direction of this magnetic field, because this is a very strong magnetic field. So they are all going to point towards south, from the north to the south. So as you can see, all my tiny magnets, all these hydrogen protons, they have now started pointing in the direction of the external magnetic field. So if my hydrogen protons are aligned with the external magnetic field, this would be called my low energy state. Because I didn't give them any energy, I just placed this molecule in the external magnetic field, and all the hydrogen protons by default, they started aligning with the external magnetic field, and this would be called, this would be referred to as your allign spin. Because all hydrogen protons are pointing in the direction of the magnetic field, or they are aligned with the external magnetic field. Now, just like the compass needle, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to make them or force these hydrogen protons to point in the opposite direction. Now, this is the low energy state. The only way I can force them to point in the opposite direction or go into opposing spin would be by giving them energy, by making these hydrogen protons energetic. Because if they have low energy, they're always going to point or align with the external magnetic field. They're going to by default align with the external magnetic field. But if these protons are energetic, then they would have enough energy and they might go in the opposing spin and they would start resonating, just like the example that we did with the compass needle. We make these protons energetic by giving them energy, and the way energy is given is by through radio waves. Radio waves are emitted, transmitted, and when they pass, they are absorbed by these protons, and when these protons absorb these radio waves, they become energetic, and when they become energetic, they go into a high energy state, and they're now capable, the energetic protons are now capable of going into opposing spin. So as you can see over here, energy from the radio waves are gained by these protons, and the green arrow now represents the opposing magnetic field. Now they're energetic. Now they're not going to be aligned with the external magnetic field. Now they're energetic, so they can now go into the opposing spin, which is the high energy state. This high energy state can only be achieved if they are energetic enough so that they can overcome this powerful external magnetic field and start opposing that external magnetic field. So this tiny magnet, this tiny hydrogen magnet, is now resonating. It's gaining energy from radio waves and it's going into opposing spin. So all these hydrogen protons, they would start resonating. So your hydrogen protons are now going to exist in two states. They're going to resonate between two states. One is the low energy state, which is the aligned spin. By default, the hydrogen protons and the magnetic fields would be aligned with the external magnetic field that is produced by these powerful magnets over here. So this is your low energy state. And if your hydrogen protons gain enough energy from these radio waves by absorbing a particular frequency, they're going to become energetic and they now can go in the opposing spin. This would be your high energy state, and this is called your opposing spin. So your hydrogen protons are going to resonate between these two states by gaining and losing energy, and that energy would be absorbed by absorbing a particular frequency from the radio waves. Remember, energy is proportional to frequency. So if a proton needs a high energy to resonate, it would absorb a higher frequency. If it needs a low energy to resonate, it's going to absorb a low frequency. Now, there are a number of factors that basically affect resonance. The first factor is the strength of the external magnetic field. So if you look over here in the diagram, if your external magnetic field is very powerful, so all your protons would be aligned very strongly with the external magnetic field. So it's going to be very difficult for the protons to go into the opposing spin, because a lot of energy would be required to go into the opposing spin or to oppose the external magnetic field. So if you have a very, very powerful magnetic field, a lot of energy would need to be absorbed by these protons to go into the opposing spin. And since energy is proportional to frequency, so a lot of energy would be required to resonate for the proton to go from the low energy state to the high energy state. A higher frequency would be absorbed, since energy and frequency are proportional. So that's the number one factor. So strength of external magnetic field. So stronger magnetic field, more difficult for the hydrogen protons to go into opposing spin. That would need, so the protons would need more energy to oppose the external magnetic field. So they would absorb a higher frequency, since energy is proportional to frequency. Now let's move. Now this factor is not very important. This is the first factor that affects resonance. This factor is not important. Remember, we are going to resonance is going to lead us in determining the structure of the molecule. So this factor is pretty much irrelevant. It's the second factor that's very important in determining the structure of a molecule, and that factor is, so second factor, chemical environment or shielding of hydrogen protons. This is what is going to be very helpful in determining the structure of a molecule. So the first thing is, what is chemical environment or shielding? So let's discuss what is meant by chemical environment or shielding. So let's say the first thing, I have this isolated hydrogen proton, and this hydrogen isolated hydrogen proton has a particular magnetic field. And initially, let's say this magnetic field is pointing in a random direction. So this is the magnetic spin of this hydrogen proton. Now remember, this hydrogen proton or hydrogen atom not only has a single proton, but it also has this electron around this proton, which is shielding that particular proton. So you can think of that particular electron as an electron cloud, which is surrounding this proton. So this is this one electron. And this electron is protecting this proton or shielding this proton from the external environment. And what did we do in NMR when we were doing nuclear magnetic resonance? What we did was we placed this hydrogen proton in a powerful external magnetic field. So here you can see the magnet, North Pole and South Pole. There's a powerful external magnetic field, and that magnetic field, that external magnetic field would be experienced by this proton. But here is where the electrons are going to come in. The electrons are going to shield this particular proton. They're going to surround this proton, and the proton, because of the shielding effect of this electron, of this only single electron, the external magnetic field that would be experienced by this proton would be a lot lesser. So electron shields proton, and so the proton experiences less magnetic field. Now, if the proton is unaware of this external magnetic field, or it experiences a lot lesser external magnetic field because of this electron which is shielding or surrounding or protecting this proton, then it would be very easy for this proton to gain energy and go into opposing spin, because it's not experiencing a lot of magnetic field. It doesn't know that there is an external magnetic field, because that magnetic field gets shielded or deflected by this electron surrounding the proton. So this proton, it would be very easy for this proton to resonate, because it's unaware of this external magnetic field, so it's going to very easily go into the opposing spin. These electrons would be shielding it or protecting it. So the greater the shielding by the electron, the easier it is for this particular proton to go into opposing spin or oppose the magnetic field, because less energy would be needed, and hence a lower frequency would be absorbed. So the resonant frequency, or the frequency from the radio waves that is going to be absorbed, is going to change. It's going to be a lower frequency, since we already discussed earlier that energy is proportional to frequency. So since energy is proportional to frequency, less energy is needed. It's easier for the proton to resonate, because it's not experiencing the magnetic field. All the magnetic field gets deflected or shielded by this electron. So the proton is pretty much unaware of that there is a magnetic field. So it would be very easy for the proton to go into opposing spin. So less energy would be needed to make the proton point in the opposite direction. Hence, energy is proportional to frequency. A lower frequency is going to be absorbed. Now, this was an example of an isolated hydrogen proton. Remember, hydrogen protons can exist in many different chemical environments. They could be bonded to many different elements. They could be bonded to oxygen or nitrogen or to benzene rings. So there could be many different environments in which these hydrogen protons could exist. And the shielding would be different each time. Now, for this isolated hydrogen proton, the shielding is pretty much constant. But if it's bonded with other elements, the shielding effect, or the electron that is surrounding this proton, the shielding effect would either be lesser or greater. So it's going to vary. And if it varies, then the proton is going to experience a different amount of magnetic field. If it experiences a different amount of magnetic field, it would need a different amount of energy to go into the opposing spin and point in the opposite direction. So it's going to absorb a different energy and a different frequency. So we're going to do some examples now of protons that are in different chemical environments. So let's think of a molecule now. I've drawn this molecule. This is the hydrogen proton over here. This was isolated initially, but now I've bonded this hydrogen proton with a fluorine atom. Now remember, fluorine is very electronegative, which basically means that fluorine is going to attract these electrons very, very strongly towards itself. So what would happen to the shielding of this electron that is provided by the single electron that was around this hydrogen proton? So as you can see over here, fluorine being very electronegative is going to drag all those electrons towards itself, and the proton is going to get very exposed. The electrons are no longer shielding this proton. So the covering, the protective covering which was deflecting the external magnetic field, that is now gone. And now the magnetic field experienced by the proton is going to be a lot stronger. So what difference would that make? One difference that would make is that if the magnetic field experienced by this proton is very strong, that would indicate that this proton would be aligned very strongly with the external magnetic field, because it's experiencing more of the external magnetic field. So the proton is going to be aligned with the external magnetic field, and it would be very hard for this particular proton to go in the opposing spin and point in the opposite direction. It would need a lot more energy, because now that particular electron that was initially covering it, that's gone closer to fluorine. That's gone. That was the electron that was shielding it or protecting it from the external magnetic field. So now this proton is going to experience a greater amount of magnetic field, external magnetic field, and it would need more energy to go in the opposite or point in the opposite direction. So here I've written everything down. The hydrogen proton is less shielded. It experiences more magnetic field and would need greater amount of energy to go into opposing spin. So higher frequency is going to be absorbed or needed for resonance. So this proton to go into opposing spin would require a higher frequency. So the resonant frequency, or the frequency that it's going to absorb from the radio waves, that frequency is going to be, it's going to be different. Now let's have a look at this ethanoic acid molecule. And you would see all these hydrogen atoms over here. We've just discussed what chemical environment or the shielding effect of hydrogens would do to the resonant frequency. A different shielding would result in a different experience of the external magnetic field, which would require a different amount of energy to go into opposing spin or resonate. So a different amount of frequency would be absorbed. Now, if you look at these hydrogen protons, the hydrogen protons are the ones that are acting as tiny magnets. What you would notice is that these three hydrogens, look carefully look at these three hydrogens. These three hydrogens are bonded to the same carbon atom, which basically means that the shielding effect of the electrons is going to be exactly the same. They're going to be identical hydrogen protons. And if they have exactly the same shielding, which basically means that they experience exactly the same magnetic field, the external magnetic field. So initially, let's assume that the external magnetic field is going from left to right. So here's my external magnetic field. So initially, all the protons are going to be, and let's focus on these three hydrogen protons, they would be aligned with the external magnetic field. So all three would be aligned with the external magnetic field. This would be the low energy state. I'm ignoring all these other hydrogen protons for now. These three hydrogen protons have exactly the same shielding, so they would be aligned with the external magnetic field. And what we will then do is we'll transmit radio frequencies. Different radio frequencies, and these hydrogen protons are going to gain these radio frequencies, and they're going to gain because they have exactly the same, they experience exactly the same magnetic field, the external magnetic field. So they're going to gain energy, and since energy is proportional to frequency, so they're going to absorb a very specific frequency. Let's call that frequency F1. And when they absorb that frequency, they're going to go into opposing spin. So they would start opposing, they would become energetic, and they would start opposing this external magnetic field over here. So all my hydrogen protons, they would start resonating. And if they're resonating, they're going to absorb exactly the same frequency from the radio waves to resonate. So F1 would be missing from the spectrum. So F1 frequency would be absorbed when these three hydrogens resonate. Now let's have a look at these two hydrogens. These two hydrogens are also identical. They will have exactly the same type of bonding and the same type of shielding by the outer electron. This hydrogen is also bonded to the same carbon atom. This hydrogen is also bonded to the same carbon atom. And remember, these hydrogens and these hydrogens, there's a difference because the environment is going to be different. The shielding will be different. This hydrogen is bonded to a carbon atom that is bonded to C double bond O on one side and CH3 on the other side. Whereas this hydrogen is bonded to a carbon atom, that is bonded to two hydrogens and it's bonded to one carbon only. So the overall effect or the overall shielding effect would be slightly different for these two hydrogens. Although the bonding looks pretty much the same, but the environment is very, very slightly different. But these two hydrogens are identical. Their chemical environment and their shielding is going to be identical. So again, these two hydrogens would also resonate. So initially, these hydrogen protons would be aligned with the external magnetic field. But if they gain energy from radio waves, which are coming in, so if they gain energy from radio waves, they're going to absorb a specific frequency and they would start to resonate. And they would all go into opposing spin by absorbing a frequency from the radio wave, and that specific frequency would be, let's call that F2. That frequency is going to be different from the frequencies, the frequency at which these hydrogens would be resonating, because these hydrogens have a different shielding. They have a different chemical environment. They have a different shielding effect, which basically means that they're going to experience a different amount of external magnetic field. And if they experience a different amount of external magnetic field, the hydrogens would resonate at a different frequency. They would need a different amount of energy to resonate. The same applies for these two hydrogens. These two hydrogens are going to be different from these three hydrogens. Although they look very similar, but the chemical environment of these hydrogens, these two hydrogens, they are identical to each other, but they are different from these three hydrogens. Because this hydrogen is bonded to a carbon atom, which is only bonded to one hydrogen atom. And on two sides, it's bonded to carbon atoms. So the chemical environment or the electron shielding is going to be different. These hydrogens are bonded to a carbon atom that is bonded to only one carbon atom. So the shielding effect is going to be slightly different. So a different resonant frequency would be for these two hydrogen atoms. Now finally, look at this last hydrogen atom. This hydrogen atom is going to have a completely different shielding because it's bonded to oxygen. And it's going to have a different amount of shielding compared to these five hydrogen atoms. So initially it's going to be aligned. It's going to be in its low energy state. All the magnetic spin would be aligned with the external magnetic field. This hydrogen proton would also gain energy. And when it gains energy, it will then go into opposing spin by gaining energy. So it's going to absorb a different frequency, F3. Because it has a different amount of shielding, it experiences a different amount of external magnetic fields, so it needs a different amount of energy. And since energy is proportional to frequency, a different frequency is going to be absorbed for the resonance of this particular hydrogen atom. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to plot this information on a graph. So I have all these hydrogen protons which are resonating. These three hydrogens are having exactly the same environment, so they resonate at frequency F1. These two hydrogens, they have exactly the same chemical environment, the same shielding, they resonate at frequency F2. And this hydrogen over here is bonded to oxygen. It has a different chemical environment or different shielding. So it absorbs a radio wave from frequency F3. So this over here is how the NMR spectrum would look like. So I have, these are the radio wave region, and these are the three frequencies that are getting absorbed. There's a frequency F1 getting absorbed, F2 getting absorbed, and F3 getting absorbed. So three frequencies. This axis represents the percentage absorption. So F1, F2, and F3 are the three frequencies. These are hypothetical frequencies. They are getting absorbed. F1 would have the greatest absorption because there are three hydrogens. Three hydrogens are absorbing the same frequency, so the absorption of F1 would be the largest. Two hydrogens are absorbing frequency F2, so its absorption would be relatively lower compared to F1. And if you look at F3, there's only one hydrogen that absorbing the frequencies or that particular frequency. So its absorption would be the lowest. So the relative height of these peaks represents the number of hydrogens that are resonating at that particular frequency. The greater the number of hydrogen resonating at a particular frequency, the higher would be the absorption. And the lower the hydrogens, lower the number of hydrogens that are resonating at a particular frequency, the lower would be the absorption of that particular particular frequency. Let's try another example, and this time I have methyl propanoate, which I've drawn over here, and I've color-coded the hydrogens as well. And I'm going to figure out which of the hydrogens, these tiny magnets and their resonance, at which frequencies would these hydrogens be resonating. So the first thing I'm going to look for is, if you look at these three hydrogen protons, they have exactly the same chemical environment. They're bonded to carbon, which is bonded to a carbon chain. So these three hydrogens are going to resonate at exactly the same frequency, and let's call that frequency F1. So all three hydrogens are going to absorb the same frequency. They have exactly the same chemical environment. They have exactly the same amount of shielding. They experience the same external magnetic field, which is why they're going to absorb exactly the same amount of energy or the same amount of frequency to resonate. Let's now look at the hydrogens which are colored in green. These two hydrogens have exactly the same chemical environment. Both of them are bonded to a carbon, which is bonded to C-double bond O and a carbon on the other side. So both of them are exactly the same. So let's assume that they resonate at a different frequency, and let's call that frequency F2. Then you have these three hydrogens over here. These three hydrogens have a different chemical environment compared to all the other hydrogens. These three hydrogens are bonded to a carbon, which is then bonded to an oxygen with a single bond. These three hydrogens, although this is a CH3, this is also a CH3, but the CH3s are going to be different. These hydrogens would be shielded differently. These hydrogens would be shielded differently because they are bonded to an electronegative oxygen atom over here. So the shielding effect would be different for these hydrogen protons. So they're going to resonate at a different frequency, and let's call that frequency F3. So let's now plot this on a grid. You have three frequencies that are getting absorbed, F1, F2, and F3. So this is how your graph would look like. Frequency F1 is being absorbed by three hydrogens. So its absorption or its height would be, relative height would be 3 compared to the others. Frequency F2, only two hydrogens are absorbing or resonating at that frequency. So they're absorbing frequency F2. So their height is going to be slightly less. So it's going to be 3:2. And frequency F3 is being absorbed by three hydrogens, three protons. So its height, relative height would also be 3. So the height is going to determine the ratio of the number of hydrogens in different chemical environments. So there are total three chemical environments, three hydrogens in this chemical environment, two hydrogens in this chemical environment, and three hydrogens that are present in this particular chemical environment.